Penguin Random House Audio presents You Can Trust Me, a novel by Wendy Heard. Read for you by Kelsey Navarro Foster and Natalie Naudus. For everyone who was born restless, may you find joy, since you will never find peace. I could not help it. The restlessness was in my nature. Charlotte Bronte, Jane Eyre. Prologue. Summer. San Francisco. I learned to pick a pocket when I was about 8. I was panhandling with my mother and two of her interchangeably bohemian friends at the Embarcadero in San Francisco. While they sat cross-legged beside a hand-printed sign that read, "The light in me honors the light in you," my job was to scope out the tourists and approach likely donors with a sad little wave. "I'm sorry, excuse me. I was just wondering if you could spare any change for my mother and me," I'd say in a trembling, timid voice, like this was the first time I'd done this, like we were embarrassed to be reduced to panhandling. I approached this one woman, a middle-aged white lady with her husband in tow, thinking she looked like someone's grandma and would probably be a good mark. Adult me would warn kid me, this type of woman is not to be approached.
"I'm so sorry, but could you spare any change for my mom and me?" I asked, smiling sheepishly and presenting my collection tin.
She stopped walking and stared down at me, lips pinching together.
"Where is your mother?"
Thinking she wanted proof that I wasn't alone, I pointed back to where my mom was in Buddha pose with her namaste sign, eyes closed, lips curved upward in a faint smile. She was meditating, focusing on manifesting what we needed today, which was $200. Her friends languished beside her, sharing a joint and calling out peace to the passersby. The fake grandma took me by the arm, marched me through the throngs of tourists, and presented me to my mother.
"Excuse me, is this your daughter?"
Her hazel eyes flew open and flicked between me and the lady holding my arm. "She is," my mom replied, ever calm.
"How dare you have her begging for your drug money? What is wrong with you? I should call the police."
I felt my stomach drop out of my gut and onto the floor. The police were our biggest fear. My mom's friends exchanged a worried glance, but she just cocked her head and studied the woman. "We're truly sorry to have upset you," my mom said. "She offered to help. I thought it was a nice gesture, and I felt badly discouraging it." She could be like this, well-spoken, reminding me that she'd gone to school, something she didn't make me do. "The world is your school," she always told me. But the world wasn't going to teach me to read, so I stole books and learned from them on my own. The woman glowered down at her.
"She should be taken away from you. You can't raise a child like this."
Panicked and angry, I wrenched my arm out of her grip. In the twisting motion, I noticed the $20 bill sticking partway out of the back pocket of her khaki pants, folded into a store receipt. My mother stood, the soft cotton of her long skirt billowing around her ankles. She was a lovely woman, her honey-colored hair wavy to her waist, her light tank top silky around her loose breasts.
"May I pray for you?" she asked. "We are going through a hard time, but it seems like you may be going through something as well."
The woman's face was shocked, hurt, and then something totally unexpected. Tears sprang to her eyes, and her face flushed bright red.
"You may not," she hissed.
She turned her back and stormed off. With no adults looking, my hand snaked over, pinched the 20, and as she walked away, it slipped out of her pocket and into my hand. And so I learned my first lesson about pickpocketing. The target must be distracted, and the friction of the item leaving their pocket must blend in with the friction they feel from movement. Pickpocketing requires empathy, knowing how it feels to be in someone's body, even the micro things like how their pants fit around the hips, how their purse slings across the chest. My mom didn't notice. She was sitting back down, arranging her skirt. I palmed the 20. I could hide it, buy things with it, save it for the inevitable rainy day when our van broke down in the middle of nowhere, and my mom decided to suddenly realize that the universe does not, in fact, provide things like mechanics. I shoved it deep into my pocket. It was mine. Chapter 1. Summer. Los Angeles. Tuesday, June 6th. The line for this abominable Hollywood nightclub is 10 miles long. 20-somethings crowd together, passing vape pens back and forth as bouncers survey the queue and beckon the prettiest people to the front. Good. For my purposes, the bigger the crowd and the more exclusive the venue, the better. I bypass the line and give the bouncer a pretty smile. He looks me up and down and unclips the red velvet rope. It's not just my ass that's getting me inside. The last time I was here, I slipped him a Benjamin. Sometimes you have to spend money to make money. Have a nice time, he says. Thanks. I stroll through the darkened hallway, pay the cover charge, and present my ID to a woman behind a little glass window. Music thumps from within like a heartbeat. My phone buzzes in my purse while my wrist is getting stamped. It's Leo. Going in, wish me luck. The words are followed by a money bag emoji and a photo of the stairwell leading to the rooftop hotel bar we cased out together. She's downtown tonight, a handful of traffic-clogged miles away from me. I reply, you got this. I think she's nervous. I've tried reassuring her we all have unlucky streaks. She'll feel better when she has cash in hand, a feeling I relate to on a soul-deep level. Money is security. Money is doctor appointments, gas in the tank, food. And we're running low. I take my ID back. I'm moonlighting as someone named Claire tonight and stow it in my bra. My car key is a hard little lump beside the license. I never keep my key in my purse. You can't tell what might happen to the things you're carrying. I pull the nightclub door open. Warm, steamy air blasts into my face along with an assault of Smack That by Akon. I cringe, remembering the theme tonight is early aughts. The club smells like booze, cologne, and sweat. I stroll through the room, getting oriented. On the left are bottle service tables, a series of booths partitioned off with velvet ropes. Ahead is the double-sided bar with bartenders working frantically, arms flashing. Cocktail waitresses dart back and forth, graceful little hummingbirds sipping from flowers. On the right is the packed dance floor, a bearded DJ presiding over it like a cult leader. My eyes follow the walls out of habit, locating the restrooms and the door that leads to the back room and service exit. I bypass dancers and tuck myself into a corner to take stock. The crowd is mostly early 20s and stupid rich, which is, of course, why I chose this club. I was tipped off by some UCLA students, and I can see in a single glance that tonight will be worth my time. A smile creeps across my face. I didn't realize how much I've been worrying about our little dry spell until now. All my energy had been used to reassure Leo. I take 15 minutes to select my people. It helps to nickname them, an old memory trick a veteran salesman taught me, so I work up a mental list that includes Yacht Chad, spiky blonde hair, expensive boat shoes, drunk, Tennis Chad, looks like Yacht Chad but with brown hair, Fitness Amber, who's trying to twerk while drinking her weight in Long Island, and med student Jen, who's going to be really bummed when she realizes she lost her ID, but who looks enough like me to be my younger sister. I move to a corner near the bar and stroll back and forth until I catch one of the cocktail waitresses logging into the point-of-sale terminal. Heidi, employee number 120801. Perfect. The DJ pivots to Milkshake with a vengeance. The crowd cheers drunkenly, and the college girls turn around so the boys can grind up on their LA-toned butts. I slip along the perimeter of the club and let myself into the ladies' room. Inside, someone is vomiting in the handicapped stall. I lock myself into the smaller stall and pull off my black dress. Underneath, I'm wearing a crop top with a deep V-neck and a pair of butt-cheek-bearing booty shorts. Two bras have my cleavage welling up to an almost comic degree. It's overkill. My chest is big enough. I can hear Leo's voice in my head, teasing me about it. But the more my boobs bust out of my shirt, the less anyone will look at my face. Speaking of which, I slide on a pair of non-prescription glasses, which will be another thing people notice instead of my features. I pull my long hair into a tight bun to hide its length, which is distinctive. It falls thick and wavy to my waist. Anyone remembering me from tonight?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.